And I see quite a few people already here. So good morning, good afternoon, wherever you may be in the world. Hello, Ricardo. Good to have you here. And before I will hand over to Ricardo Skidic from Sonopec, I will just run quickly through a few slides from technologycatalog.com. So a few basics in terms of the interaction. If you have any questions, we will address them at the end in the Q&A. But feel free to use the chat box on the right at any time to just put your questions there, and we will address them after the presentation. Content, the materials, so slides and so on, will be provided in the wrap-up email. Please bear with us there. They will be coming your way at the end of the week at the latest. And one practicality, where to find the technology Sonopec on technologycatalog.com. And that nicely segues me into the agenda, so it's indeed just a split. Quick overview of technologycatalog.com, then the presentation of Sonopec by Ricardo Scottini, the business development manager, and the Q&A, and that should bring us to around 30 minutes. Of course, if the Q&A is very heated, we're not going to cut it off, and everybody who has to go at the half-hour mark is, of course, excused. So, where to find technologies on technologycatalog.com? Well, there's three ways around it. Either I know exactly what I'm looking for, and I use the search bar at the top, filling in Sonopec, for example, but I could also type in something like coating, and that will also give me a suggestion of relevant technologies. Or maybe I want to browse per industry, so in blue here. Or third option, I can also look at cross-industry themes such as safety, for example. But today, we're clicking on oil and gas, and we will be sent to the submodules in which we would choose pipelines and subsea, for example. And if we click that, that will then indeed bring us to the selection resting under the submodule. And by a nice coincidence, we can see Sonopec here in the second row already on the left, highlighted in with the red square. But let's say we're still a bit overwhelmed here and we want to narrow down our search even further. We can use the most relevant as well as other filters on the left-hand side to really zoom in on what exactly we're looking for, and that should make our search as efficient as possible. So if we're clicking on, let's say, Sonopec for today, we will be sent to the tech page. Every tech page looks the same and is set up as the following. Top left, in blue, we have a short description. Resting below that, pros and cons. Top right, technology readiness level. Below that, video, photos, and other animations. And then in red, a contact form where you can contact the supplier directly, or you can have a look at the website or call them. The only requirement we have here is that you're a locked-in user, apologies, but the rest is for free. Registration is free of charge as well. And if we scroll down, we're treated to a few more informations. On the left, you see the specifications. Below that, the business impact, and if the supplier chooses to do so, a deployment record. And lastly, on the right-hand side, you can see reviews written by independent experts. Those will never be anonymous. So in this one, it is Martin van der Heuvel, the principal consultant of Misi Consultancy. And you contact this tech expert via the contact button, so via email, or go to his LinkedIn page to get more feedback on the review he's written. If you would like to hear more about it, then you can reach out to the relevant tech expert per technology. So that really is. So if you would like to list your technology or host such a webinar, hear about our premium services, or just have a coffee chat with me virtually, feel free to reach out to me under nicofreitag@technologycatalog.com. But this is really everything from my side, and it is my pleasure to have Ricardo here today. Ricardo, over to you.
Now, I hope the microphone works.
It is a bit low, but I think if you speak up, then we can hear you well.
Okay, I will shout. Let me check. How can I see the slides?
On the right-hand side.
Yeah. I see that presentation. I guess it's like this. So I hope everybody can see the slides.
Yes, we can.
Welcome to this webinar or presentation, introduction to Sonopec. And what it is? It is an equipment based on pulse eddy current, and is one of the best tools to detect corrosion and also monitoring that. So if you look about some applications, we have a large experience and track record as company, also as a development team. And the technology is mainly applied for corrosion under insulation detection, corrosion under fireproofing, for example, the support of spherical tanks, the legs, but also skirt of vessels. There are special tools that combine with other technology can help to quantify the corrosion under annular plates of storage tanks or atmospheric storage tanks. The technology may be easily used for corrosion monitoring in service. It may apply on a high temperature application, even on heavy corroded equipment like in steel company. And also it may be deployed offshore to inspect riser, caisson, underwater to inspect some part of the structures, on the deck to inspect the installation, like at least that is very similar to what you see in refinery and oil and chemical plants. How does it work? Pulsed current is generated by a sudden interruption of a magnetic field. So it may be applied on carbon steel object or low alloy carbon steel. And what do? We have sensors. With this sensor, we can create a steady magnetic field. And the duration of this, DC current or steady magnetic field we create depends on the thickness of the plate we are inspecting. Just to give some idea, 5 to 7 millimeter. We talk about 50 millisecond duration, so it's very short pulse. It's something like 20, 25 millimeter, we talk about half seconds. So how thicker is the object, how longer takes the pulse? And why does it take longer? Because we need that the magnetic field lines start to get steady and uniform in our plate or pipe. Once this situation or condition is reached, we can suddenly interrupt this external magnetization. And we will have a transient of magnetization in the material itself. And this change of magnetization will induce eddy current. The first eddy current or pulse eddy current, because they are generated after a pulse or interrupting this external magnetic field, start to be generated on the probe side of the plate. And they start to migrate through the plate and diffuse until they reach the bottom. So in this slide, we see on the left a simulation of three times steps of this eddy current, highlighted in blue, moving through the plate. So we have 1, 2, and 3. And on the right side, we see the signal in function of time. So the amplitude of this signal in function of time. And we see the eddy current are in stage 1 and 2 diffusing through the plate. Once they reach the opposite, they have no material to go on with diffusion and the signal drop down. Now, we can relate this signal to the electromagnetic property of the plate that are magnetic permeability and electric conductivity, and extrapolate or calculate how thick is or how much material we have underneath. So if the plate is thinner, this bending point or this characteristic time will, or this pulsed current will decay earlier. If it's getting thicker, will decay later. Just to give maybe a better explanation, I just simulated a plate. So it's a carbon steel plate. We see the gray area underneath. There is insulation above that, is what we see here. And of course, most of the time is there's a weatherproofing sheeting made of aluminum or stainless steel. Sometimes the insulation could also be foam glass, for example, or any, in general, not magnetic and not electric conductive material. When I place a probe on the good side, what is seen in blue, and we take a measurement, we see a signal. If I place the probe on a corroded area, my signal will be shorter, it's the line in orange. So in this way, I can detect how corrosion it is. So what we see is a way of measurement that is very similar to, for example, what you do with ultrasonics. The back wall moves to a shorter time when the plate is getting thicker, thinner, and when it's getting thicker, move to longer time. Now, the equipment fit in a box. The box is 76 millimeter, and it's about a weight of 30 kilos. What do we find in the box? We find our control unit, which is a laptop with all the electronics. We found the battery packs to operate the electronics. We do have a contact probe to perform measurement in contact or through scabs, scaling, corrosion product, and even coatings. We have other connection probe cables and chargers. And probe for high liftoff, commonly used for COI or COF application, so corrosion under insulation and corrosion under fireproofing application. Then we have a probe for TF probe, is for the annular ring of atmospheric storage tanks. We have additional batteries for the laptop to assure you can continue working. And of course, to charge them, we have a dual bay charger. The probes. So we have mainly four probes. We can see in this slide, we see the tank floor, coded as TF probe. The FV probe is the stronger probe that can go up to 200, 250 millimeter insulation. Wall thicknesses up to 70 millimeter. The AP probe has a little bit slower application range, goes insulation up to 70, 75, sometimes 80, and wall thickness up to 30 millimeter. And if you look about the contact probe and even the tank floor probe, they have application with a wall thickness up to 1 inch, so 25 millimeter, and also liftoff or standoff are also up to 1 inch, 25 millimeter. So if we have, for example, a pipe with a thick bitumen coatings, we can easily inspect and with the contact probe. Something about applications, at least the specification of the equipment. First of all, we keep innovating our technology. And in this way, we are also improving not only the equipment, but also application and way to use it. For example, building the electronics in a pod, and the pod is mounted an ROV, and the ROV goes 3,000 meters down in the sea and inspect, for example, jumpers or some installation that is at the depth. On the other side, the technology can be just fixed on crawlers. And we have some dedicated crawler that can climb, for example, on aluminium surfaces, so on the above the insulation, cooperation with other companies. And in this way, we can deploy it just to inspect the vessel or to inspect some piping without the need to have a rope passes or to reach the object physically with and place the probe with the hand. So the wall thickness goes from 2 millimeter up to 70 millimeter, depending on the probe. The object insulation thickness is up to 200 millimeter, in some situation to 50, when the plate is very thin. So I talk about 5 to 7 millimeter. Object temperature can be up to 550 degrees. This limitation is mainly due to the Curie temperature of carbon steel, which is approximately around 750 degrees Celsius. And what do we see? That approximately 200 degrees before the Curie temperature, the material start to get, I cannot say unstable, but there are some oscillation in the measurement. So there will be a large deviation in readings. So up to 500 degrees is okay. Pipe diameter larger than 2 inches. If the pipe is not insulated, we can even inspect 1 inch or with a small coating, small insulation at least. And the accuracy is 95%. It means this is, of course, referred to the reference location, reference measurement. And we see that all the other reading will be plus minus 5%. So if the reference location is about 20 millimeter, all the reading we do are within the millimeter tolerance. Repeatability under the same condition is 98%. It means that this deviation by repeating a measurement will be in plus minus 2%. The equipment can operate in a large environmental temperature range. It's from minus 20 degrees Celsius up to 50 degrees Celsius. And this limitation is mainly due to the GTEC laptop we use for the controlling the equipment, but also to analyze the data. It may operate in humid environment, and it is best waterproof with IP rating 65. And of course, it's cost benefit as we have a dedicated probe, which can be used for different application and even specific application. It's robust, there is no moving part, and the electronic is a state of art for pulsar decurrent. It means that the pulsar, receiver, filtering, encoders, the whole electronic is built up for this, let's say, pulsar decurrent. It's really dedicated and it's battery operated. This is a possibility we have to adapt, connect more probes and also to perform encoded measurement, is what we see in the picture. So this is an animation, but the equipment does exist, and this is the real situation used in some validation done for clients. Using a multi-probe belt or a chain scanner is, on some way, it can improve the production. So we're covering a larger surface. We can perform more measurement at the same time because the measurements are real time and simultaneously with all the probes. On the other side, the counterback is that more probes start to get be heavy. So if you inspect in some situation, it's better to deploy the tool with ROV or crawlers. Now, if you look about the control unit, is electronic, also the eddy current electronic, our Sonopec electronic, a laptop, and we have a software. Now, we have different functionality in the software. We have lots of algorithm to present data, analyze data. In this case, we see on the left side corrosion monitoring, where we can see exactly when the corrosion starts, when it stops, where is the deepest point. Of course, we have also statistic analysis of the results, and we see where are the most results, and if for example, green is good condition. When it starts red, it starts to get worse. Orange is getting even worse. We can also set up the software as it is very flexible. For example, like traffic lights. Green is like a good location. We could say orange is a location that need to be monitored. And red, for example, could be used for areas that need to have a direct action or repair. We also have a defect mode, and the defect mode analyzes the whole signal. As you may see, with pulsar decurrent, we inspect an area of the object. And this area depends on the footprint size of the probes. And the footprint size varies also with the distance of the probe from the plate. So in a way, on the thickness of the insulation. And but in this average area, or just say volume of material we get information, that may be thinner areas. And the defect mode analyzes the signal and identify if there's a thinner area in the signal itself. We do also have a reporting tool, and the report can be easily edited by everybody and can be loaded, and data goes exactly where you want to be. And of course, we have a 3D modeling like a pipe or elbows, and other objects are under designed right now. For example, vessels. For inspection, we perform offshore. We even have risers, and we can, for example, also register where is the tide level, the high tide level, the low tide level, and all other additional information that can be useful for the interpretation also of the results. As benefits and conclusion is pulsar decurrent and Sonopec is suited for risk-based inspection, is mainly a non-intrusive inspection technology. The data collection is fast, is a direct real-time interpretation of the results. There is no insulation removal needed. The surface of the object doesn't need to be cleaned or prepared, for example, like what is necessary for performing ultrasound measurements. It's also not affected from the rugosity of the surface. So if the surface is not clear, heavy corroded, we can perform the measurement and get information about the volume of material, the good part of the material still under the corrosion. It may be deployed with a rope access, just cutting down then the scaffolding cost with ROVs, with crawlers, with extension poles. It's a very interesting tool for in-service corrosion monitoring, and it delivers accurate corrosion rates information. The technology is effective above and underwater, as water is not influencing the measurement, the measurement principle, the method, and is unique for examination of non-piggable subsea pipelines. So pipelines that cannot be entered from inside out, they can only be inspected from outside. And pulsatile current is a very interesting tool to go through this heavy concrete on the covering the pipes or through the coatings protecting the pipe, and allows to see how the pipe wall thickness inside is, so how thick it is. Maybe interesting is also to know that the innovation team or the PEC team, the SonoPEC team in Tuve Islands Innovation has, so everybody in the team has 20 or more years experience with the pulsatile current. I started in 1999, so nowadays approximately 22 years. And this helps during all these years to see application, situation, and this know-how help us to design an efficient, tailor-made solution. So I think now we reach, I believe, the end of the presentation. These are my contacts. And if you have, it's time for questions.
All right. Thanks, first of all, Ricardo, for that presentation. I think it was very, very interesting, very engaging. And I will skip my personal questions because there's actually quite a few questions in the chat box. So I'll just go through them chronologically. And the first one was, how was the tool validated on real insulated materials? So what geometrics were used? Straight pipe, bends, T's, nipples, and so on?
Yeah, in a way, the validation by client is always, what can you find? So most of the time you have, what I always do is I exactly explain based on the probe we use, based on the wall thickness, based on the insulation thickness or the standoff. I always say what we can find and what we cannot find, because you cannot find everything. Yeah, I mean, for example, what I didn't see, say, is a pulsatile current as it is, has quite a larger spot compared, for example, to ultrasonics. This means that if it's ultrasonic, you could find, if you're lucky, I have to say, pitting corrosion is not a type of corrosion that may be easily found with pulsatile current. Pulsatile current is mainly to find more generalized corrosion, to inspect pipe through the scabs, so to thick corrosion scaling, for example. It may be used to size pitting, but not pitting we find in chemical. It's too small. Pitting we find, for example, on riser offshore. They are quite large, kind of craters with thick scabs growing on them, and then we can say something.
Okay, so I think that odds.
For example, one of the questions is, Luke seems to say internal corrosion of the pipe and can identify if it has internal corrosion. It's an interesting question, for example, just from Ahmad Al-Mansour. And it can, what you measure in a way is the thickness of the plate. If we, because in real situation, the insulation is never constant, it's difficult to say is the corrosion internal or external. On the other side, if you're inspecting a pipe with coatings and we see, for example, a wall thinning, so a shorter signal, but the amplitude of the signal is not changing, then we can assume the insulation is internal. But why? Based that the coating is quite constant.
Okay, great. I hope that answers your question, Ahmed. And I believe, Stephen Moss, we also touched upon whether the probe can identify pitting or larger loss of wall thickness. But if you would like to hear more about that, just let us know in the comment box there. Just scrolling a bit down here, so Paulo Steenkamp also asked what the minimal defected size defected, sorry, what is the minimal defect size detected by the tool? I think we touched upon that already a little bit, but
yeah, in a way, just to give an idea of some dimension, the footprint size can roughly be estimated with, I would say, 1.75 or 2 times the lift of the instance, so the insulation distance plus the wall thickness. So imagine we have a plate and starting over, with a diameter of approximately 40 to 50 millimeter.
Okay.
We see okay. Then that by increasing the distance, it increases. Now, to find an indication, this extension should be at least half size of the footprint. And we also need, of course, a volume change between a good area and an area with indication that should be more than 10%. Then we have also something else, this defect mode. When the indication is, for example, about half of the extension, has an extension on half of the footprint size, we can still quite accurately size it. At least in the 10%, we have the minimum wall thickness in our footprint. When it starts to get smaller, just to 1/3 or a little bit smaller, we can easily detect, but not size as accurately. But that at that time, we know what we found.
Okay. All right. That I think that also segues a bit to another question from Paulus, which was about false positives and false negatives. I think we're somewhere close there.
Yeah. It's very interesting. We have done some voice validation, for example. And our equipment came out with the lowest false negative rate. Mm-hmm. It means that everything we found, it was there. Mm-hmm. And for the, let's say, other company, it means that many other, at least I can say, this maybe could give an idea that we are more in control in what we are doing, so that our software is helping. We see a deviation, but it's not a defect.
Mm-hmm. All right, great. And I see the questions are coming in, so that's why I'm just jumping on them. And I'm trying to keep the Bitcoin logically so we don't lose anything from them.
For example, of Martin van der Heuvel.
Exactly, yeah.
Can you explain the way tank inspection work a bit more in depth? Mm-hmm. Now, I have to say, originally, Sonopec, maybe... Something more about me. I've worked until 2015 with RTD. There I was experienced with Incotest. Sonovation was the service provider for Shell deploying the PEC tool, so the Shell PEC tool, and which was acquired by Sonovation in 2014. Mm-hmm. And in 2015, when I joined, so I started to learn how this PEC tool was working. And one of these probes really surprised me for the, I could say, the possibilities, because the tank probe in is very, very thin. It's about approximately 3-4 millimeter thick, so it's a very thin blade, and it can be inserted underneath the annular ring of tanks. What we also see when we have some corrosion in tanks, most of the time is also the annular ring a little bit lifted, allowing access to water underneath. But the inspection, in a way, is done in combination with other technique. For example, long-range ultrasonics, what in RTD use, for example, the name LOROS. So it's a wide beam ultrasonic angle, and they scan on the annular ring, looking inside a storage tank in service. So the tank is full of products. When they detect corrosion, they can size a little bit the distance from the shell. But they cannot really quantify, they can estimate maybe a kind of, I can say, classification of corrosions, but they cannot exactly size it. Now, what can we do with these PEC probes? We can calibrate with ultrasonics on the annular rings, the part of the plate outside the tanks. And then we insert it and we perform measurement, and they are absolute value in these cases. Mm-hmm. So there are values in millimeter or inches, depending where you are in which area of the world you're living, or which metric is used. And on the other side, what's happened is the application was really successful in the Netherlands, where most of the storage tanks are on sand beds. So it means it's quite easy to insert the probe underneath and reach the corrosion and quantify how much it is.
Okay.
In other parts of the world, tanks can be in a basin or with a concrete annular ring. So at that time, in that area, we are, if you're lucky, we can go through. Another, we will stop to the ring.
Okay. I hate to cut you off because it's very interesting, but I see we're already over time. We have three more questions. Okay. I would like to address them at least a little bit. So Stephen Moss had, as a follow-up to his earlier question, was essentially, does it pick up if the plate has stratified or scaps flaking off from parent material? So it's the is the third top question, Stephen Moss.
Yeah, Stephen Moss, does it pick up the plate? Has stratified scaps flaking off? No, is the technique is really looking not at the scaps or notice what is stratified, but just the carbon still underneath. So the material that is still good. We are not looking to the corrosion. To the corrosion product itself, so we and that's why we can, you know, when you have corrosion, sometimes there are also you have more product, look like that everything is thicker, but that thicker part is not what we're looking for. We're looking to the parent material, so I think it's only that.
All right, great. So, and if there's any more follow-ups, Steve Moss or anybody else, also we will address the last two questions. But of course, we will put everybody in touch. So if there's further follow-ups on this, I'm sure Ricardo is more than happy to jump on a call with you. But to not ignore maybe the last two, and then we'll call it a day, I would say, is from Stephen Gunn. He asked, are the probes encoded, or do they require an additional scanner or crawler for dynamic scanning?
Yeah, the probe itself are still the original, I can say, reproduction of the shell probes. They had no encoding, but we have probe holder where an encoder can be clicked on. And then the cable on the encoder can be connected to the to the electronic box. The probe cable has a possibility to have an encoder in the cable itself. So we consider this situation to for future probes that will have an encoder plugin, for example. What is interesting is that I think is one of the only equipment that has X and Y encoder. So we could connect a probe on a on a scanner that is moving, for example, radially around the pipe and then actually along the pipe. And we could monitor also with more probes where the measurements are taken.
All right, great. Thanks for that. And last question would be from Yves. Okay. Yves Desmet, I hope I pronounced it correctly. Can measurements be done in ATX zones?
Yeah, that's an interesting question because the equipment is not ATX certified. But we have some offshore operation where we enter wells. Is a core business application, or core business of Tour Islands Innovation, where we inspect wells and we enter the sea annulus, which is can have explosive products, but also it may be under pressure through a lubricator. And the tool that is entering is ATX certified. It means it will not create any spark, any, say, is not a source for an explosion. But the equipment itself, normally when we operate it in, in ATX area where there are dangers, we have monitors and we see how the situation is, like, in a way, like an ultrasonic equipment, the same way to operate it.
Okay. So, somewhat yes to answer that. Yeah.
Yeah, in a way, it's yes and no. Yeah.
Perfect. All right. I would suggest also mindful of time a little bit. I'm sure people have to run off somewhere. We'll call it a day here. But again, very informative. Thank you so much for being on, Ricardo. I think it's a great technology. Thanks, everybody, for tuning in as well. As promised, slides, video material, everything will be provided within the following days. Feel free to reach out to Ricardo. If there's any question on the right set, feel free to reach out to me as well. I'll make sure Ricardo gets the message, but we will get any follow-up questions answered. If you liked this technology, sign up for technologycatalog.com. It's free, and we provide you with a lot of interesting, innovative technologies. Take care, everybody. Thanks so much, Ricardo.
Yes.
Bye-bye. All right. Bye-bye.